All right, guys, I'm finally ready. Sorry about that. It is March 7th. Eventually, your systems are going to get bigger, meaning you're going to have like more than what we do today. There are systems of inequalities that can contain lots of inequalities. Ours for this class, for this journey, just have two. So we're just going to have two inequalities. And if you know how to graph one inequality, there's really very little extra meat on the bone here today. So I have some examples. I don't have them numbered, so I'm just going to kind of guesstimate what order I want to do them in. So let's do this one first. So you saw systems of equations. You've already taken multiple quizzes that involved that. You had your systems quiz, and then you had the word problem quiz that had systems on it too. So we're familiar with how to solve systems. We are not going to obviously talk about elimination or substitution. We're very specifically going to solve systems like this by just graphing them both. So let's begin the process. Let's take this one with the red check mark next to it. And let's start to manipulate it first. So when I want to graph the top one, what would I do first? You betcha. Let's move that x to the other side. So we're going to leave the 2y alone. And remember, please, it's March. Let's get this straight. When we move the x, he changes to negative x. And then the 4, since he didn't move, stays as a positive, but we write it as a plus 4. And then let's finish the job. What do we do lastly? We divide by 2. And since we're not dividing by a negative, we don't have to switch any signs at all. So everything stays exactly as it is. And when we divide by 2, I sometimes like to show this step, then I'm going to get my y equals mx plus b. So I'm going to have y is greater than what? Negative 1/2 of x plus 2. Very good. So that one is now in a perfect done, ready to graph state. So since I'm recording all this and you're taking notes, I'm going to try to just clean up my workspace as I go. So I'm going to erase all my work and I'm going to erase the original problem. So now we're on to the second one. That's this fellow with the yellow check mark next to him. What would I do first to get him ready for graph? Yeah, let's just subtract that x across. So let's just leave the negative y on the left. And let's keep our sign is less than. And again, when we move that x, he switches to negative x, and then the positive one stays and becomes a plus one. And then the last step here, we divide by the negative, which is a big deal, right? Bless you. With equations, it's a big deal. With inequalities, it's an even bigger deal because when you divide by a negative, you could call it negative one. Remember, that's always something you can do if you like that better. When you divide by that negative, then everything gives you all four signs change, like the y, the inequality, the x, and the number. They all get the switch. So we're going to have y is greater than, what will my slope be? Yeah, just one. So 1x. So I could just put x. And then what's my y-intercept going to be? Negative one. So minus one. Good. So again, I'm going to do a little house cleaning and get rid of some of this. And so this is an expected part, as you know by now. Sometimes you don't have to do it. I think on a third of the problems today, you won't have to do it. But when you do, you just do it. Takes a couple minutes, get Y by itself, and you're ready to rock and roll. So let's do the red line first. Now, where will I start the red line graph? Well spoken, up to. And what's his slope?
Down one.
Down one, right two. Very good. And remember, you can skip ahead. You can do like do a bunch of up ones and left twos. Like they don't all have to be right next to each other, but you want your points to be as far apart from each other as they can be, so that when you connect the super far dots, you're always guaranteed to get a good accurate line. So I'm going to graph the line, and I have to fix mine, right? We've had this conversation before. It's a dotted line, so make sure before you graph yours that you remember to make it dotted. Now, something different today is I'm not going to shade. What I'm going to do, I'll let you draw your line, say, because this part to me is pretty important. You have a couple of options here. When I, let's just do one for now. Okay, good question. Rather than doing the shading at this point, what I like to do is draw arrows, just a few arrows to indicate directionality. So like this one is y is greater than, right? So I'm going to do this. I'm going to put little arrows, maybe three or four of them, that indicate the direction that I intend at some point to shade. And I'll tell you in a moment why we're not shading yet. But then I'll also show you if you like to do things artistically, like with colored pencils, you can shade. You'll see. You'll have to just decide, am I an arrow then shade person, or am I a shade, see where they cross person? So you decide. And now, yeah, let's do the yellow line now. What's his starting point? Down one, and his slope is up one, right one, up one, right one, up one, right one, up one, right one. So you could do that a bunch of times. Yeah. And again, draw a line. And I have to modify this one as well. So I don't know why this little box did not used to pop up in my Zoom meetings. And I feel like I've had this dilemma before. Where can I put it somewhere? Oh, I could put it right there. I don't like it. And I got to make mine dotted again, right? So I'm going to go back and fix my line. So remember, if you graphed your line already, make sure it's dashed. You should be pretty familiar with this process by now. And again, I'm going to draw arrows. Instead of actually shading, I'm just going to put arrows to indicate the direction. And the arrows in this case, since it says is greater than, are going to go above, like this. And here comes kind of the new part for the day. What we want to understand about a system like this is shading really technically should only exist where both situations are happy. So for example, like if I made a big green dot right here, is that point a solution? It is not, because it might be above the yellow line, but it also has to be above the red line. So I would not expect on your paper to see any shading where the green dot is. Likewise, if I made a big purple dot, that's not a solution either, right? Because yeah, it makes the red line happy, but it doesn't make the yellow line happy. So what winds up happening is we only shade in the region where the intersections overlap, and our shading winds up looking like this. So when you graph a system like this, you're going to get multiple different possible appearances. One of them is a wedge like this, a triangular wedge where two lines come together and you try to make them both happy at the same time. That's what it looks like to graph a system of inequalities. You graph them both, but shading really should only exist where the overlap is at. Some people like to do it more artistically. I'm not one of those people, but some people like to do some shading like this, just some light shading above the yellow line. And then some people do some light shading above the red line. And then what they do is when you do color, like my technology doesn't do it, but if you use like a red colored pencil and a blue colored pencil, what will you see? The purple will be your solution. Yeah, purple. Right. Thanks for that. You'll see some purple. And so some people like to do their graphs. It looks a little cooler like that. So if you're into that kind of thing, when you use actual pencils, mine don't overlap and make different colors with each other, but you would see, like in this case, yellow and red, you'd see like an orange, which I don't have. So anyways, I prefer the arrow method, just it's tidier and this just feels to me. So that's how you solve a system of inequalities by graphing like that. And so you might sometimes in the future be asked, name a point that is in the solution region, and you could pick any point that's within the purple, right? Like that. So like it don't ever be confused. If someone says, okay, then name a point in the solution. We're not asking you to reinvent the wheel here. We're just saying, like, hey, there's a point, name it. Like, here's another one. Name it. I don't care what, just pick a point, name it. Right. Good, good. So that's the long and short of how you do it. So I have some special case sort of examples for you that I want to go through. Again, moral of the story, just graph two inequalities, see where they cross, shade where they cross. So for this one, Let me try to find a special case one for you here. This one's going to be a special case. So let's do y is less than x minus 2, and y is greater than x minus 1. You come to appreciate a problem like this because I don't have to do any actual math, right? Some people are like, yay, I just grab it. So these are ready to go. There's no getting y by itself. So let's start with the red guy, that conversation. Where do we start the red graph?
Negative
Down to, thank you for not saying negative two. Down to, what's his slope?
one.
Up one, right one, up one, right one, or just go up a bunch, right a bunch. Remember, you don't need to have a boatload of points. I think I've said that you do in the past, and that's not really what I meant to say. I've always just meant to say you need points that are far away from each other. So just do a few, spread them out though. And is this line going to be solid or dotted?
No.
All right, so I'll have to go back and fix again. No biggie. Let's draw some arrows while we're here. Where will our arrows go off this boundary? Downwards. The red line clearly says y has to be less than me. And remember, from our practice, we know less than means below. So the arrows that are red are going to point this way. And that's just a reminder for me. So visually later on, I can see where the shading will wind up. So arrows going downwards. How are we going to start our journey with the yellow line? One, and what's his slope? Up one, right one, up one, right one, up one, right one. Like such. And again, we have a dotted line. So I'm sort of overloading you with dotted lines here this morning. Did I hit that okay? I think I did. Yeah. Oh boy, I'd missed the mark there, didn't I? Oh boy, let me just take. No, I'm gonna go back. What a klutz. That was my bad. I remember the first time I graphed. Yeah, so the reason this example made its way onto my note card this morning is because, like Brendel noticed, these lines are parallel, right? And so you know that something interesting is going to happen when two lines are parallel. Where will my arrows go from this one above? So where will the yellow arrows and the red arrows coincide? Never. Yeah, and I appreciate the sentiment. You're trying to find an answer to my question, but at the end of the day, let's think about it. If you shade above the yellow line, which I'm going to do only just for visual effect. So if I were to shade above the yellow line like this, and I were to shade below the red line like this, you would agree there is zero chance of those shadings ever touching, right? It just can't happen. There's that empty sidewalk in the middle that's like a blocker that prevents them. So in a case like this, your graph would have no shading on it at all. And then you're welcome if you'd like, also in addition to that, you certainly don't have to, but you're welcome also to just make it official and say, this system actually has no solution because there is no point at like at which the two shadings would ever come on top of each other. You know what I mean? So that's one possible scenario that is a special case, we call that. The shadings just might not cross. And that will only happen, obviously, with parallel lines. It's the only way it could happen is with parallel lines. So let's take a look at another one. Oh, I need a new page. Let's do. Oops, I meant to switch colors. Oh well, let's just pretend this one is yellow. Deal? Good. I would say it's a Monday, but it's not. It's a Thursday. So let's do the top line first. Where do we start him at? Don't say negative three. Remember, negative three means over here. If you let me choose, I'm just going to be stubborn and pick that. Down three. Get you guys all to say that here. That's my mission for the end of the year. Up, down, up, down. Down three. What's the slope? Down four, right three. Perfection. Or if you want more workspace, you can go back up to the upwards four and back to the left. That works just for you too. Solid or dotted? This one's going to be dotted. This one does not have the equal sign with it. So remember, we're doing the top one first here. So because it doesn't say greater than or equal to, I'm going to make my line dotted. I'm hitting you with a lot of dotted lines here today. Let's put some directional arrows, some indicators. Which way is this graph going to go? Up. Put as many as you like. All right, let's go to the line with the yellow box around it now. Where are we going to start that graphing journey at? Up four, good. So up one, two, three, four. What's his slope?
Oh.
You're fine. You're right. Down four, and then. So what is the slope? Down four. Right three. Good, good, good. So down four, right three. Down four, right three. You can tell the theme of this particular 6 or 7 minutes of this lesson is that interesting things can happen when you have parallel lines, right? That's really the purpose of this little stretch here. So let's take a look at what we're working with. Again, we find ourselves with parallel lines. Where would the arrows go off the yellow boundary? Downwards, good, because this is a less than, and that is a solid line. So that's our first solid line of the morning there. And bless you, where will the shadings overlap? The middle. It's a sidewalk. I call these sidewalk graphs. It looks like you're walking down a sidewalk made of purple concrete here. So your shading in this case only exists in that long sidewalk because you got to stay capped above the red one, while also staying capped below the yellow one. So they each sort of block each other's progress, if that makes any sense at all. So that's one way that, so there's two special cases. There's the special case in which they just go away from each other and never cross parallel lines. There's the special case in which they shade towards each other and form that long sidewalk. Does anyone know what the third special case just might be? They do. They can actually go the same way. And I want you to see what that looks like when we're graphing. So we'll probably do that one and then maybe one more after that, and then we'll be done. And then you can work. So. So let's do y is greater than negative x minus 4. And y, switch colors there, dude, goodness gracious. Y is greater than negative x plus 3. Right, this'll finalize this portion of your notes, the special cases portion. Parallel lines can cause kids a lot of stress. So there's three things that can happen. They can shade towards each other and make the sidewalk. They can shade away from each other and be no solution. Or like Gage said, they can actually go the same direction. And let's take a look at what that means for us. So let's graph the red line first. Where does he start? Down four, one, two, three, four. What's his slope? Yeah, good job. Down one, right one, down one, right one. Solid or dotted? And remember, don't put it. If I haven't made this pretty clear, I'm kind of partial. I don't think you should shade yet. I think you should really just commit yourself to the arrows. Just go with that. Let that be your thing. So we're going to go above and just draw some little indicators to say that this is where the shading would be. Right. And now let's head to the yellow line. Where will I begin him? Job. Up three. And what's his slope? Same as the other guy, right? And again, we have ourselves a dotted line. So I'll put it back with my eraser, fix my line like this. Where will his shading eventually go? Up. So this is an interesting scenario, and you'll see another version of this in Algebra 2 when we do some strange compound inequalities, that two things, when they point the same direction, we have to stop and think about what does it mean for both of them to be true. So let me ask you this. If I put a purple point right here, you see my purple point? Is it a solution? No. You have to ask yourself, am I making both lines happy? And if I'm that purple point, I'm like, I'm the man. Look, I'm making red line happy. But then yellow line's like, hey, what about me? Like, you have to think about, am I in a region that makes both arrow sets become true? So any point in that sidewalk is not a solution because you're limiting yourself to just solving the red line. So the purple point is out. Where would the shading be? Above the yellow line is the correct answer. If I'm anywhere up here where this purple shading is, I can now say that any point in that purple area makes both lines happy. You'd have to probably agree with that. If you just pick some random point in this purple area, guarantee, like if I just pick this big white point, whoop, right here, is he in both? Yeah, he sure is. So you never really get to see the red shading. You just kind of only shade where they cross. Simple pimple. All right, last thing, I just want to make sure I throw one of these in and then I'll be done. I know that took a little while, but one more, okay. And I had a couple more. I think I cut it down to five, maybe. Is this our fifth one?
Yeah.
Okay. So I had seven, so I figured you probably got this. I think you're going to be okay. So let's look at this one. All right, let's go do some algebra. We haven't had to do any actual math in our last few problems because I gave you all the whys already, but this time I'm going to make you work a little bit. So let's go solve that red one. What do we do first with the red? Nice. And actually, that's all we have to do is just move the x. So we get y is less than what? Negative x plus 1. The x changes, the y, the 1 does not. So red guy's ready to go. How about yellow guy? What do we have to do with yellow fellow? Right. And remember, this ain't our first rodeo. Like, if we divide by negative 2, we're not going to fall for it. We're not going to make rookie mistakes. We got to be real sharp when we divide by negative. What's our answer going to be? Top notch, guys. All right. You fought it off. Good job. So these are our two inequalities ready to go. So the reason this example has made it into the cut or made the cut is because one of the lines is special, right? And I just, no matter how many years I teach algebra, I still have to go over and over and over and over the whole horizontal vertical thing. So let's graph the red one first. Easy peasy. Where does red guy start? Up one. What's his slope? Like I've said before, I find it quicker to do just a few really far parts. I think that's quicker than making all the little staircase jumps. So this will be another dotted line. And don't neglect little things, like don't ever become a lazy grapher. Always use a ruler and always put arrows on the ends of your lines, right? Just let those be the habits that you have. It takes an extra, just a couple seconds to be good at it, to be, make it look good, make it proper. Where will I shade? Downwards. So I'm going to draw some little directional indicators to say that shading could go here eventually. All right, let's throw in Mr. Yellow. Where does he start his journey? What is he? He's vertical. So to start a vertical line, you never go up or down because that's going to form a horizontal line. Like if I go up 4 and then go across, I'm like, ooh, I did the wrong kind of line. So I go to the left 2. and make my point at negative 2, and then I graph a vertical line shooting down through that point.
Go to your other side, not like a pizza problem.
Yep, this will be a, I didn't know what you meant at first when you said pizza pie, but now I get it. The little triangular thing. Sure. Like how the when you eat a slice of pizza, how it comes to a point. You betcha. Yeah. So I need to make this one. This will be dotted for sure. Yeah. So, okay. So yellow line is ready to go. And my directionality is going to be to the less than. And as you learned from yesterday's homework, you know, less than, just follow your heart, dudes. This is the only kind of line in the world where we can't say above or below. There is literally no above or below. So I just default to common sense. Less than, of course, means to the left. I mean, you could try to make a case, but I just don't know how you could sit there and with a straight face say, I think we should shade to the right. Numbers get less as we go left, not right. And then you, like Addie said, it's the, you see how they come to a point, right? You can see where the reds and the yellows would agree, huh? And so I'll do purple for my shading, and it's going to look like, going to come down below this, but then it's going to bank and make a turn right here because I've got to be capped by both. I've got to make the red line happy, but I've also got to stay left of the yellow line like this. So that was five examples that I think it covered just about everything that could happen to you. Regular ones, solid dotted. And then you got the sidewalk problem, you got the above both problem, and then you got the just no shading problem. So that is that. So with that said, I'm going to pause this and hand out your worksheets. Okay, so here's your assignment up here on the TV. If you're already started, good job. If not, let me get you going here. So we're going to take and we need to do math on both of these. So let's start with the top one. What would I do first on the top equation or inequality? Get that x to the other side. So remember that the y does not say 2y when you're done. It's still a negative 2y. So we have negative 2y is less than what? Negative x plus 4. Good. And then what do we have to do to get y by itself? Say again. Divide by negative 2. Very good. So that's going to give us y is what? Greater than. Good job with the sign switch. Greater than. What's our slope going to be? It's actually positive 1/2. Okay. X. And then what's our y-intercept going to be? Minus 2. Good job. And that's going to be a dotted line. So let's all go to down 2 and make our first point at down 2. And then what's the slope?
11.
Up one, right two, up one, right two, or down one, left two, down one, left two. Again, I it breaks my heart that I'm still having this conversation with you. Just stop doing your slopes wrong. Just stop. That's all of you. Stop. It's not one person. It's not five people. It's not 10 people. It's still a lot of people. So if it says positive number, hey, make it go uphill, right? So we're going to graph a line. We're going to make it dashed. And where will our directional arrows go? Up. Nice. So we've got some little directional indicators there. All right, let's head on to the second one. And that'll be the bottom one. What would I do first on that one? Yeah, so again, we're going to be left with our negative 2y. You're right. And you'll start to get good at this and you'll start to know this is a special case, honestly, before you even start. Because look at the structure of the x's and the y's. X minus 2y and x minus 2y, they're going to produce the same slopes. So we already knew going into this that we're working with parallel lines. So let's finish the job. Let's divide by negative 2. What do we get? Y is greater than what? Positive 1/2 of x. Nice job. Solid stuff. So we're going to start our journey at up 3, and then we're going to again go up 1 and right 2. All right, we're going to make another line, We're going to make it dashed or dotted, call it whatever you like. And where would the shading wind up trying to go on this problem? Above, good. So if we go above the red line, and we also have to be above the purple line, where will we in all reality wind up shading? Yeah, give me a little more specificity than that. What's my shading going to, where's it going to go from? Just above the red line, right? Remember, the purple line doesn't have a lot of clout because he's like, you can be above me, but that doesn't do us any good unless you're also above Mr. Red. So our shading in this problem should only exist up here. So that's a special case problem. So there's a couple more in there somewhere. You guys think you got this without, you probably don't need my help anymore. You good? All right. And we will work on this more Monday. So give me 9 more good minutes. Let's finish out class strong. Get maybe 2 or 3 more problems done, 4, I don't know. And then we'll have some more time on Monday.